Well, it's quite evident that you're prepared to abandon traditional ways of sitting. For years, people have thought that if they sat down, they had to sit on a chair. But now you've demonstrated that this is not necessary, and for centuries people have thought that if you have an architect, he puts up a building. Now, I'd guess from this that you don't think quite like that.
Well, I think that, you know, some of the things that we do at the end of the day probably appear fairly traditional. I think that it's in the nature of questioning everything that sometimes that the answer to somebody's problem is not necessarily a building, and it might seem kind of rather odd for somebody who's supposed to be traditionally in the building business to be presented with a problem and to perhaps solve that problem by eliminating a building. I guess in the same way that in terms of our own house, we would prefer to sort of define what you know, what relaxing means. It might mean a chair, and you know, in other rooms in the house we sit on chairs. In this particular room, you know, we find this more relaxing and a bit more to do with, you know, with the way that we like to live.
Well, now, if you have a client who comes to you and says, now, I'm going to run a factory or whatever, now, this means that if you're going to cope with this in a way that you say, you may say you don't need a building, this means that you've got to examine how your client actually functions as an organisation.
Yes, I think that probably that first stage is very central to our activities. I think, you know, traditionally, a client comes along, he's got a statement of his needs, and he hands it across to the architect. The architect kind of disappears into a garret and comes out triumphant with a solution and kind of feeds it around a group of specialist consultants, and somebody at the end of that exercise might say, you know, it's too expensive or it won't stand up or whatever. And eventually that process goes through and it's handed out to a builder, and the builder builds it. That tends not to indicate, I suppose, the way that we work. We get very involved in the briefing activities, in almost going perhaps full circle into a management consultancy field, defined rather tentatively. Mm. And sometimes that at the end of the day might produce something which looks quite familiar, but can produce results which are perhaps totally unfamiliar, especially with organisations which don't really know what the next move might be, or they might need, say, space, and they might need it very, very quickly, and that might be a non-traditional building, or it might be that we reorganise their existing premises.
Well, now surely it must arise that when you are dealing with a specialist client, you may not talk their language, and they may not talk yours. For example, you're dealing with the Fred Olsen terminal down in the docks. Now, I don't imagine that an architect every day comes up against the problems of dealing with shipping. So could you understand what he was talking about, and did he understand your explanation in terminology that you've used now?
This is really a question of communications. I think the important thing is that we saw the whole exercise is really a problem-solving activity. And in terms of structuring that problem, we were talking about the same things as Olsen's were. In other words, how much time, how much money, the problems of moving people, goods, you know, the fact that you couldn't separate out any one activity from the others because they all related together.
Yes, but you had to do this in a great hurry, didn't you?
Yes, it was a frightening program. I mean, this particular building here had to be virtually designed and built in something like 12 months.
And everything was happening in that time.
There are a number of activities happening simultaneously. I mean, the terminal, for example, here was actually built whilst the quayside was in full operation.
Yes. Well, now, you had to deal with all these problems. That is, you had to provide somewhere for the dock workers to wash and eat and so on. You had to enable passengers to come off the ship. Now, how do you set about this problem? How do you start it?
I suppose by surveys.
For example,
we were here about sort of 6:30 in the morning and sort of taking photographs and taking measurements, dimensions, counts, a work-study exercise, if you like. At the same time, we were talking with docks committees, foremen. We were also talking with management, analysing the whole range of problems, you know, at different levels, and studying the interactions between them. Again, the important thing is you can't separate out one activity from the other because they all interrelate together. So I think we're talking, you know, a total situation.
But now, take the passengers coming off the ship now, and you've got to get goods off as well. Now, I can see down there that they're operating at two different levels. Now, but mostly when I've come off a ship, I've come down onto the dockside. Is that a...
Well, I think, again, the situation was that, in a way, at one point, we came right down to ship design. We got involved in the ships.
whether the doors open, and actually at one point really questioning the design of the ship. And this was very exciting. But no, I think that the facility, the buildings, are the solution is part static building. In other words, the tube, which you see elevated there as a concourse, and also the movable links. In other words, it's part industrial design, it's part architecture in a more traditional sense. And we're obviously concerned that people moved independently of the trucks, because the ships are rather unusual. They're special to Olsen. They side-load by a stack of trucks and pallets. And we were anxious that we could move passengers so they didn't interfere, so you could get a smoother turnaround, a more efficient operation.
Now, it strikes me that to do this, you had to have a firm which understood very well the problems and was prepared to cooperate, and also had a situation in which your ideas could work.
Yes. I think we are fortunate in that they're a very progressive company. I mean, in terms of labour relations and so on, one doesn't need to elaborate around that. It's pretty well known. I think this, again, comes back to communication. They're very sensitive about communication. So when we were talking together, it was kind of, you know, free exchange. In other words, they were very open to new ideas, new thinking. By that, I don't mean that they would accept anything easily. It would be necessary to you know, advance a case and then, you know, justify it, to explore the whole range of options. A very stimulating client to work with, in actual fact.
Well, now, where you have to deal with people working on the dock side, there's the complicated control of the actual operations of unloading and shipping movements. Now, were they going to put these people into separate offices, put them into separate places on the dock side, or what was their idea?
They didn't have preconceptions about this. They knew the way that they'd done it in the past, and to a certain extent, there was a hangover from the way that things had always happened in docks in the past. And the standards around dockland, by and large, are pretty well known. I think that we had an opportunity to present a number of rational analyses of the problem in terms of people, in terms of communications, in terms of what management were trying to do, in the way that they were raising standards. And I think that we were able to translate these in building terms. I'd like to think that we made a contribution in terms of pointing out that the possibilities for open planning, a company which is fairly dynamic, which goes through changes, so that you can alter layouts, a company which as a corporate entity has a kind of family feeling about it, where you know, it's not really sort of building up on physical barriers or psychological barriers. And I think the exciting thing is that we were able to get directly involved with the user through docks committees, so that, you know, if we talked about amenity facilities, they could say, well, we'd like to play darts, and we could discuss the possibility of incorporating this. Or can you design a room for eating and dances? Bingo, you know. It's very exciting.
One aspect of all this that worries me slightly is that I have the feeling that, efficient though this approach must be, there seems a danger that the human element, the people using it, come to be regarded as elements in the whole machinery, and that they become manipulated as well.
Yes, I think that what you're coming back to is really the role of the architect, what the priorities are, what it's all about. And I think that we're aware of change, and aware of the way that our role is changing, the kind of things that we're doing. But I think at the end of the day, the thing that must make it worthwhile is a joy in the situation. In other words, it's no use being able to say, you know, we can build that building in half the time, and, you know, if we're getting an inflationary curve and building costs are going up at 13% per annum, then if we can do a four-year building program in 2 years, then that's fantastic, you know, financially, in terms of the client. Also, if we can talk flexibility and say that things will change over a period of years, you know, that might be good. If we can say that we can build a building for a certain cost, and that's a highly competitive cost by design ingenuity, you know, and follow that through and come within that margin, all these things are great. But absolutely central to this, otherwise the thing is absolutely worthless, is that there must be some joy in the building. I mean, the building is about people. I mean, an environment, whether it's, you know, whether it's a new house, an old house, a conversion, whether it's sitting in front of television after supper, whether it's working in an office, a factory. I mean, it is about, you know, upgrading a situation. So in the end, a value for money thing is negated if at the end of the day you create a slum, or you create something which is, you know, which is dull. So surely what it's all about is creating something which, you know, which...
Well, in your own terms, for example, if you're dealing with the environment in which people are going to work in an office, Now, presumably, you can provide perfection in the way of air conditioning, heating, lighting, and so on. But now, at what point do you make a decision about the effect of this on the people using the office? Do you take expert guidance on the psychological effect, or is this an appraisal that you yourself make?
No, I would say that the that coming on to this, one would come back to the team approach, and that sitting around the table, depending on the type of project, there might be your sociologist, your management consultant, your mechanical engineer, your electrical engineer, perhaps your industrial psychologist. It depends on the particular project. Mm. But all one can do to try and emphasize this is to say that from the outset, one is thinking, the design team is thinking, in total terms. And the priorities of that design team are to produce something that is efficient. And if something is enjoyable to be in, and this is, again, comes back, I think, to this.
Well,
to
it's the just to take an example. Now, one fashion has been for designing offices as a sort of landscape, hasn't there?
Mm-hmm.
Now, is this, do you think, likely to last, or is this a fashion? Does it, in fact, answer human needs, or does it harm them? What happens to that, for example?
I think that's a very kind of loaded question. I mean, we're very aware that people have, that it's become a kind of cliche, around that it's a fashionable thing to do, that the answer to everybody's problems is to landscape.
Now, one conclusion that all you've said does lead me to is that it seems very rare that there comes a situation where you, as the architect in the way you function, you actually have an imaginative gesture which manifests itself in something which stands in the landscape which we, the public, look at and regard as a beautiful object. Do you think that the architect actually, you as an architect, have a function to produce something like that?
I think it's fashionable at the moment to talk about many of the things that perhaps, we've touched upon. And it's unfortunate that some of these things perhaps surface. We talk about landscaped offices as if they could be considered in isolation, or air conditioning as if air conditioning could be considered in isolation from a whole range of other factors. I think that the one particularly worrying aspect is that we can talk about systems, we can talk about coordination, we can talk about cost control, but the architect, in our terms anyway, and as an office, as a group, as a totality, we're very much committed to the idea that the architect still has an absolutely fundamental role as an artist in the traditional sense, in the beautiful things department, if you like. One could probably define a number of parallel roles. You could say that the architect was your artist in that way. In other words, trying to do the best out of every situation, trying to squeeze the maximum amount of joy, often in the face of kind of overwhelming odds outside the control of the architect or any of the consultants, the designers, co-designers involved on the project. You could say that he has at a certain point in time perhaps a chairman role in terms of coordinating a vast range of specialists, developing a sensitivity towards the needs of the person who actually builds the building or the group that builds it, developing a sensitivity so that he can communicate and liaise with the organisations that he's working for, so he can talk their language and they can feel, a kind of a confidence and a trust and so on. And perhaps, an emerging role as a systems analyst. The buildings are getting more complicated.
Could you just explain that? Now, what is a systems analyst?
Well, I mean, without going into this in depth, let's say that that not that long ago, if you were talking about the things that made up the cost of a building, the structure would be there. It would hold it up. That would account for a tremendous, proportion of the cost of the building. When buildings get more complex, then the infill within the building starts to become important. If you take, for example, a school, the equipment in terms of teaching aids, closed circuit television, the carpet, the furniture, the air conditioning, can account for a sizable proportion of the budget. So, and each of these elements starts to have its own specialist groups concerned with them. And I think we come back here to the need for a common language, because in the end, the best building solution will inevitably be the best compromise.
But finally, you are still proud to be an architect, to bear that name and the responsibility that it implies?
I think the responsibilities are overwhelming at times, but the answer must be yes, because in the end, you know, you either have confidence around a situation and the ability to handle it, and in the end, somebody has to squeeze the maximum out of every situation, which is a matter of balancing all the conflicts and trying to get the best possible equation.